systemic biology and ecology, and then from University of California, Berkeley, she holds her PhD. She's been at the Santa Fe Institute for a while, really shaping the future of the research there and interdisciplinary work. And so it's been very exciting for her to be here at CREE, and she'll be talking to us today about roles, function, and impacts of humans in complex ecological networks. So let me introduce her. Or welcome her, whatever.
I may or may not sit the whole time. Let's see. I'm still slightly jet laggy, so although now is, I guess, wake up time. So I study complex ecological networks, and I sometimes like to go back to Darwin for this, because at the very end, upon the Origin of Species, he wrote, of course, very famously about the entangled bank. And the entangled bank, of course, being species interacting with each other and dependent on each other in complex ways, and that those the entangled bank and these complex ways of being dependent on each other are produced by laws acting around us. And of course, he became famous for evolutionary theory and evolutionary laws, but there's also a lot of possible ecological laws out there, and I think networks are one way that get us there. As a way of thinking about entangled banks more quantitatively. Not that long after that book was published, the first picture of a food web and a scientific article about a food web was published by Lorenzo Camerano in 1880 in an Italian journal I don't think exists anymore, but I should look it up. And was promptly lost to science until a couple decades ago when colleague Joel Cohen rediscovered it and had it translated and republished it. So that's really cool. But so these those give names of species, the groups of species, and then there are arrows, you know, pointing between them to show the feeding interactions among them. And this is more the kind of data and depiction that you'll see for food webs, complex ecological networks today. This is a data set that was compiled a couple decades ago by my colleague Neo Martinez. And we have some software that we use to visualize and analyze ecological network data. If anybody's interested in that, just let me know and I'll send it to you. Yes? You want it? And just to like show you what we're looking at, the spheres, of course, represent species or groups of species that have functionally identical roles. And the line between them are actually, they are directional feeding links, they're cones actually. The vertical axis actually has ecological meaning in this case. It's trophic level. It's the number of kind of levels that a species is from primary producers, which are at the bottom. So I'll scan a little bit. You know, so down here we have algae, because this is a lake food web, and then you have zooplankton on top, you know, feeding on the algae, and then you have various insects and fishes, and you'll see nose rings sometimes. Anybody want to tell me what that is? That doesn't already know. Cannibalistic. So cannibalism is actually extremely common in ecosystems. It's almost certainly underrepresented in this data set and most food web data sets. But of course, it's an interesting ecological phenomenon. This is my slide that summarizes thousands of articles and, you know, several decades of research in one slide, or one slide in three parts. So over the years, we've learned quite a bit. We've a lot of different kinds of data been put together. We've learned quite a bit about aspects of ecological network structure for food webs and also for other kinds of ecological networks like pollination networks and other bipartite networks. So zillions of articles have been published on that. And we've learned also a lot about how to model and think about and understand complex trophic dynamics, which I won't really be talking about much today. But again, many, 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 many hundreds of articles, interesting papers. And even a few that sort of, you know, get to the point of taking models of dynamics on complex food webs and applying them to particular real world data sets, in this case, like constants. And we've also learned a lot about how to use ecological network frameworks, both structural and dynamical frameworks, to try to think about, quantify, and understand ecosystem robustness, stability, and function. So a lot of work has gone on in across all of those areas, including some work that I've been involved with. And people have been studying food webs quantitatively and comparatively and using modeling since the 70s. Bob May, you know, was very famously involved in some early food web type modeling in the early 70s. Joel Cohen was the first person to compile a food web database to do comparative work using very primitive data, shall we say. But we're constantly looking for opportunities to improve our methods and our understanding of our data underlying empiricism. This is just a little side note. We've had opportunities to push food web research in different kinds of interesting directions. Because this talk is really mostly about deep time, but not super deep time, I will talk about super deep time for a second because it's fun and it's something that I got involved as a pushing as a research agenda, and that I think you're going to start seeing a lot more work coming out of over the next decade. Food webs and geologic deep time. You know, so up there, of course, here we are up in the Holocene. Here we go back to the Cambrian, which is the major radiation of multicellular life on Earth. And I actually was able, through collaborations with Doug Irwin and other people, and he's the curator of the Burgess Shale at the Smithsonian, among other duties. And then Conrad Labandera, who's also at the Smithsonian, is an expert on a more recent ecosystem of the Messel Shale. So I'll just really briefly take you through this, because mostly I want to talk about humans. But this is kind of cool work. And did the paleobiologist make it?
No, John's not here.
Well, he's missing out. So, of course, the Burgess Shale, most of you have probably heard of, I hope. It's the most famous fossil assemblage. It's had many, many interesting and, in some cases, controversial books written about it. The most recent one written by my co-author, Doug Irwin, who's also associated with the Santa Fe Institute, the Cambrian Explosion, the Construction of Animal Biodiversity. And, you know, the biome of the Burgess Shale is very interesting. It's over half a million years old. You know, and it had a very, it was, you know, the diversification of multicellular life and also of body forms. And there's a number of body forms that just don't even exist anymore. I mean, so these are marine creatures. Of course, that's all there was, and you know, and they were about as different in terms of being, you know, multicellular macroscopic organisms as you could have from then to now. And we got a bunch of paleobiologists together and tried to figure out how we could possibly infer feeding links to possibly construct food webs. And and actually, the way this even came about, when I was a postdoc at SFI, a very unfortunately long time ago. I gave a talk on food web research. This is probably in like 2001, 2000. And this person came and sat next to me at lunch, which is kind of typical. I had no idea who this person was. But he said, do you think that we could do this for really, really old ecosystems? And I, as an ecologist, was like, what do you mean, like, from like 100 years ago? And he's like, you know, like, you know, like hundreds of millions of years ago. And I'm like, sure, you know, what kind of data do you have? Let's talk about it. And that person turned out to be Doug Irwin, who's very eminent paleobiologist, and hence this kind of project was born. And so we got together and figured out, I mean, there's a ton. I mean, obviously, we actually know quite a bit about the taxonomy and also phylogenetic history of organisms in the fossil record, and especially these things like the Burgess Shale, which are called Lagerstätte, which have very high preservation across all trophic levels. Soft body bits were preserved, as well as, you know, bones and shells and things. But there's a ton of ecological information also in the record. And so, you know, you have things like, I mean, you occasionally have gut contents fossilized. That's, of course, great, you know, and that's pretty high certainty. But you can tell a lot about, like, what kinds of teeth organisms had. You can match up teeth to bite marks. So damage patterns are very important. You know, so they basically came up with a bunch of different lines of inference. And then those allow us both to to hypothesize a link. Every link is a hypothesis, but then also to assign a certain level into that link. And again, I'm just rushing through this because this isn't the main point of the talk, but this is a food web that pops out of a lot of effort by Doug and Rachel Wood and others to put the data together. We published this a while back, an analysis of this in the Shang Shale food webs. But then just to keep going on the empirical side for a minute, jumping up to the Messel Shale biota, so now about 50 million years ago. So now we've gone from creatures that look nothing like modern creatures to things that are very much like modern organisms. They're different sizes and they've evolved since then, but you have horses, they're little horses, but they're horses. You have fishes, you have hedgehogs and fishes and crocodiles and beetles. And again, there's a huge amount of information about who's eating whom within this data. And this data, I mean, Conrad, it took years and years and years and years, but he pulled together this just incredible data set that for the Messel Shale, which is a lake web surrounded by a paratropical forest food web. This is a more highly resolved terrestrial food web than we have for a modern ecosystem. That's a whole nother story. And it's very high certainty data. It's really incredible. So this was published a few years ago. But one of the things we asked, I mean, just very simple, simple thing to ask, or something that I'm always looking at is, how do we compare across these different food webs? Do they have similar, totally different kinds of structures? And actually, comparing network structure across networks is a very hard problem, as you and I have talked about, and as Stephanie knows. It's not trivial. It's not a settled thing of the most rigorous and best ways to compare network structure. But we have our ways of comparing them. And basically, as you start looking across different habitats for modern webs, and then even looking across these ancient webs, you start to see common patterns popping out, similar degree distributions. So this is a simple network structure model called the niche model. That does a very good job of describing all the structures across all these different food webs. The point with the Burgess Shale is it doesn't matter, how far back in time you go, it doesn't matter what kind of habitat you go to, you see very common underlying patterns of how food webs are organized across ecosystems. And it's still an open question as to why that might be the case. Again, other conversations for later, but just wanted to kind of tease you a little bit with the deep, deep, deep type stuff. But really, what I'm here to mostly talk about is my other recent sort of foray and fascination with what about Homo sapiens? We are another species on this planet that interacts with other species and feeds on other species. And, I got interested a while back in can we use a food web framework in order to think about aspects of humans and ecosystems? And in particular, I got interested in the questions of whether and how we can use ecological networks to assess human impacts on ecosystems, to understand human roles in ecosystems, and also if we could ultimately use it to investigate new or different aspects of sustainability across time. And so I'm going to now, the talk will be kind of in three parts from here on out. The first part will be the human impacts on ecosystems very briefly. And then I'll go into the human roles within ecosystems, and then we're going to move to the last piece on beyond feeding interactions. So I'll just briefly go through two case studies. Obviously humans are having a huge impact on ecosystems and on biodiversity. I don't need to tell you all that. But it's only recently that people have really started to compile data, or figure out ways to think about human impact specifically on the ecological networks. Webs. And I'll just give you two examples of that. One that I was involved with is one that's on the Adriatic Sea. This was published a few years ago in Ecosystems. I was a minor, frankly, co-author. The work was mostly done by Heike Lotz and Ricardo Cole, colleagues up at Dalhousie University. And basically they compiled a lot of data across many tens of thousands of years for humans and other species in the Adriatic Sea ecosystem. Adriatic Sea, of course, being between Italy and all these other countries, including Croatia, Slovenia, Serbia, Montenegro. Well, Serbia's not right on the Adriatic Sea, but it's close. And what's the new, what's the other country?
Transnistria.
Was that Robin, by the way, in the picture?
I'm sorry?
Was that Robin in the picture? Do you know?
No, I don't know. Yeah, so anyway, so they compiled all these different kinds of data across different cultural periods that aren't divided evenly through time, but you know, everything from like hunter pre-human, hunter gatherer, to classical, medieval, modern, global stages. And I'm going to show you very little of this, but one thing I'll show you is this is the species abundances across these different cultural periods. The colored lines show different kinds of animals, groups, so you know, this is coarsely resolved. It has to be. The gray line shows humans, of course, no big surprise here, as the human population explodes over the last few hundred years. You know, the other species populations are drastically declining. This is relative abundance. Most things really started crashing in the last 200 years again. No big surprise there. Birds actually started earlier because they were, people like their feathers and their eggs. So we're kind of getting on bird populations fairly early. But they also, we also did a little food web piece of the study, and in this case, unlike with the, actually the really deep time stuff like mesal shale data, they could only put together fairly coarsely resolved networks. It's actually harder to do highly resolved food web data through shorter deep time. But again, this is showing the transition from early modern to late global, so over the last 100 years, up until the early modern, the food web doesn't really show evidence, at least at this coarse level, of significant changes. But then you lose 25% of the taxa, so they either completely leave the scene or they go ecologically extinct, which just means they're at such low levels that they're kind of destined for extinction. I mean, and this is local, it's regional extinction. But you can also, when you have these networks that